Hello, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Kurion. Sorry we weren't here last week. We had a couple of people off with various different means. I had no internet as well, so unfortunately we were not here last week. But we are back, of course, and I am joined, as usual, by my crew. My name is Stuart, and I will be your DM for this evening. Why do I sound like a maitre d'? But regardless of that fact, last session, it wasn't last week, our party continued to make their way through the broken dwarven hold of Kalraz Horkel, eventually finding their way to the Hall of the High Lords, where they bargained in exchange for some water for the last piece of the Fane's heart needed to access these inner chambers. After doing so, they found themselves in the Hall of the Ancestors, within which they noticed that there was a distinct lack of statues of Fanes within this hold. Beyond lay the great bridge towards the Fane Seat itself. Crossing it, they were confronted by a beast of shadow that walked up from behind them, charging across the bridge. They narrowly made it across, slamming the door in the creature's face before they were seemingly in a field, having a chat before nightfall with the Fane themselves. In a series of flashes, they took down some Ettins alongside the Fane, witnessed the finding of the first lantern, the creation of more lanterns, finally the finishing construction of the largest lantern, whereupon their vision faded to darkness once more, and a voice echoed in their ears saying, "You cannot take it. It is mine." And that is where we'll pick things up right now on this, our adventurous tale. As the voice echoes around your ears, your vision begins to come once more into focus. You see tall, grandiose stone columns, walls lined with murals depicting great and valiant deeds of various dwarfs throughout the years. And for a moment, it is that almost pitch blackness before you hear this sickening hum that reverberates in the pit of your stomach, and from behind you, you see a purple flash. As you look around now, you are all in a circle, your backs to this great bronzen lantern that sits on a pedestal between you all, and the sickly purple light that illuminates from there scatters across the room. And in the edges of its vision, atop the mighty seat of the Fane itself, you see a flickering creature of shadow, tendrils of darkness, wisping off like parts of a beard. You see the figure, the unmistakable diadem crown, the great axe in their hand, of the Fane, far larger than any dwarf should be, towering above you. The creature has their eyes fixed upon you all as the lantern begins to brighten and brighten, and as it does, the sense of dread lingering in your back of your mind pushes itself more and more to the forefront as nausea begins to overtake you. What do you do?
God. I should probably attack the really big dwarf. That's the way I'm feeling right now.
Mm-hmm. Unless any of you got any other plans, Gunn's just going to run in there and swing.
Yeah, it's a Colossus. Needs slaying. I'm a Colossus Slayer. Let's go.
Alright, well then, in that case, I would like everyone to roll for initiative.
Oh, hey, I did good for once.
Fuck me.
Not so much.
That's always a good sound.
Natural 20.
Ha, would you like to swap, Steve? Because I got the exact opposite.
Wow. Yeah, sure. I'll try it. Can we try, Steve?
No.
Maybe swap it.
25 to 20.
24.
21.
All right, don't all go at once. Jeez. Ronan and then Tilly. Oof, okay. And you got 20, Tristan, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. 15 to 20. That's good. 10 to 15?
13.
13 for Willow.
I'll just have a nap until my 10.
Yeah, okay. It'll be a while till we get there. 5 to 10?
7.
Nice, nice. One to five?
Four!
Four. Ace. Great. Okay. So, before we get into this, I'm just gonna go through a little bit of how the battlefield, the different bits of the battlefield, so you're not all confused about what places are. So, this in front of you, this line that goes along here, I'll use the ruler to show it, this line here, that is a 10-foot up, straight up wall. These are stairs that go up that 10-foot to the top here. This drop here as well, these are also 10-foot drops. So every drop is 10-foot. Okay. Any questions about how it looks? If you get confused, just ask. But for now, first up is Ronan.
Hunter's Mark. I remember it this time. Hunter's Mark. And okay. Then I'm just going to unload the two rounds from my crossbow.
Okay.
So attack one. So plus 10. That's 23 total.
That does hit.
So that's just a d10 and a d6.
Yep.
7. 12 points of damage.
12 points of damage. All right.
And then second attack.
Yeah, this is with your crossbow, right?
Yes.
Okay.
27. And that's Colossus Slayer as well.
Yes, indeed.
That's going to be 16. 21 points of damage.
Dang. All right. Okay, so you watch as you let loose both of these bolts into the looming figure of the Fane. Both of them sink deeply into the shadow and are just seeming, the bolts are seemingly lost within it. There's no sign of flinching or any movement from the creature, and the bolts appear to sink through what was originally looked like plate armor. It just sinks into it. Would you like to do anything else for your turn?
No, I'm fine with that.
All right, which brings us to Tilly.
So I looked it up, and on a running jump, I can clear 9 foot vertically. So I'm going to run 10 feet, jump 9 feet back up here and climb up, which is 19 foot of my movement, so basically 20 foot.
That's 10 foot up, though.
Yeah. So that's basically 10 foot of movement. I'm taller than 1 foot. I can grab after a 9 foot jump.
Yeah.
And then I will dash, and I assume I haven't seen these things at the top right.
You will have when you get up there. You see this sort of this looming armored figure.
Okay, well, I wager my bets better with those, so I will dash and move around here.
Okay.
And then I guess I still have an action.
Yes.
Because I could dash as a bonus. I will throw a dagger at that front one.
Okay, go for it.
That's a natural 20. That's a good way to start.
Yeah.
On a d4, which I immediately threw off the table. So that is 1 on the first roll, 3 on the second. So that is 8 piercing damage.
8 piercing damage. So this
done better.
This dagger flies into this creature, and you hear it like that, the sort of crunch of metal, like opening a can, as it sinks into the armor, but the creature does not flinch or moves the same as the Fane, does not even reach up to take the dagger out. It just sticks there. in the sort of the clavicle.
Cool.
So, and then the lair is going to take its action. So, as you stand there now, the lantern flares and pulses, and I would like everyone within 20 feet of it to make a constitution saving throw.
Oh, thank fuck, it's not wisdom.
Which is everyone but Tilly.
Running away is good for you.
If you've got the chance to. It's a big ol' 9 from me.
12.
13.
19.
17.
Okay. So, Tristan, what did you get, Ronan?
19.
19. So, Tristan, Ronan, Namari, you...
13.
Yeah, you all pass. The rest of you, however, take 6 points of necrotic damage as the sickly light from this lantern courses up your back, and you just feel this horrible lurch in your entire form. And that will end its turn, which brings us to Tristan.
Okay, I would like to mock it viciously and in Dwarvish shout out, "Well, you don't look very happy, so which of the 7 dwarves are you then?" And then... I can move through sort of allied spaces unencumbered, can't I?
Yes, as long as you're not stopping them.
Yeah. I'd like to move over to here, then. And inspire... Yeah, I'll inspire Namari.
Okay. So that is a wisdom saving throw, right?
Yeah, wisdom.
That's an 18, so...
Yeah, it says.
All right.
Do I still get a charge in the room?
Yeah. You cast a spell. All right, which brings us to Bologna.
All right, so... Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm going to move away from the glowing thing, because, no thank you. And then I'm going to cast Guiding Bolt at it.
Okay.
So I have to scroll down to the spell. That is a 16 to hit.
Against the Fane.
The big thing, yeah, the Fane.
Unfortunately, that misses. As the light crashes into the form of the Fane, it just seems to dissipate around.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. All right, well.
Did you do anything bonus action or anything?
Nah.
All right, so that brings us to the Fane's turn. Right. So the Fane just looks over to... his left, and turning into sort of this void, almost half void of darkness, it shifts towards you, Tilly, and it's going to make 2 strikes at you with...
Yikes.
The X. Okay. I
was hoping to avoid that.
So the first one is a 13 to hit.
That does not hit.
The second one is a 29.
That hurts.
Okay. So, I would like you to make a wisdom saving throw.
Oh boy. I'm not very good at these. Especially when I roll a 5.
Okay. All right. You take 22 points of damage. Yeah.
Five
of which is necrotic, and you, as the axe slams into you, knocking you almost to your knees for a moment, it seems like the axe itself just wails, and you hear it in your ears. You are frightened until your next turn.
Oh dear.
And that will end the Grungil's turn, which brings us to Namari.
So we're standing around the lantern, a huge lantern here.
Yes. It's huge, it's made completely from bronze, and it's fixed to this thick stone pedestal.
Is it... Can I look inside, see if there's a creature inside? Because, I mean, we saw creatures being forced inside the lanterns last time.
You can certainly look, yeah. I'll say it'll take your bonus action.
I want to do that then.
All right, so... you pull yourself up, because it's quite tall as this lantern, you pull yourself up and you look inside, and you just... see this light echoing outwards, but for a moment you see something shift. sort of the light shimmers.
It's potentially stupid, but I want to break the lantern.
Okay. It's a metal lantern. It's with like holes in it. There's no glass to it.
Okay. Can I with Eldritch Blast?
You can certainly try.
Yeah. That's 7 plus 8, 15.
That will unfortunately miss.
Natural 20 on the other one.
That one does hit though, yeah.
Is 7 plus 5, 12.
Okay, so the first one just scatters across the surface of this. The second one hits it, but you see that the entire form seems to just shift. As it's blasted slightly apart, it shifts back into place, and your blast doesn't seem to have as much effect as you would expect.
Is it too late to remember I could have uncanny dodged?
Unfortunately at this point, because it's a me, yes. All right. Would you like to do anything else of your turn?
I want to step away from the lantern a little.
Okay.
Just yeah. Muttering under my breath, just what is this place? God damn it.
So once you're done moving, that will bring us to Gunn.
All right. So for me to, if I was to clamber up the platform, like, would that just take 10 foot of my movement?
You would have to roll to climb.
Yeah, yeah. It's like
so,
a strength check.
It's like a sheer wall. So
that's cool. Well, I'm gonna rage for a start.
Okay.
And then I'm gonna clamber my cute dwarven butt up there.
Okay.
So I get advantage because it's a strength check, right?
Yes.
Good, because the first one I rolled was a 2. I need to burn all my dice. So that is a 23.
Okay, all right. So, looking at this wall, you take out an axe, one of the ones you bought from the blacksmith, and just slam it in, using it to pull yourself halfway up so you can reach to the top and just barely grasping onto it. Your fingers turning white, you pull yourself up.
Because I'm so swell. Right. So, has that used any movement?
That was 10 feet of your
10
movement.
10 feet, okay.
Actually, climbing counts as difficult terrain. So that's 20 feet for everyone.
Right. Okay, well, I still got 15 left to play with. 5, 10, 50. Fuck, so close. I'm going to just throw the axe I used to climb up at him.
Okay. Go for it.
Okay. 19 to hit.
That will hit.
That's a d6. Which was 1 plus 6, 7.
7 points of damage. So as it sinks into the creature's form, you notice that barely seems to have an effect on it.
Yeah, and I just like shout at him, like, leave her alone!
A blast.
Okay. And at the end of your turn, Gringle is going to use a legendary action. And from Gungil's form, you see this lash of darkness just swings out towards you, Ronan. And I would like you to make a strength saving throw, please.
All right, strength. 5.
So, as this lash comes up, it reaches around your body and just yanks you careening towards Grungo. And as you pull through the air and you land slamming into the floor, you look up to see the glowering gaze of this fane just staring down at you. Which will bring us to the guards. This one's going to move up. This one's going to move to here. This one's going to move to here. So they, one of them pulls out a warhammer and is going to hit you with it, Tilly.
Cool.
That's going to be a natural 19. So.
So yeah, that hits.
Would you like to uncanny dodge it?
Do I have to do it, or do I have to wait for the
it's damage? A reaction. It's on hit.
Okay, well, yeah, nothing else is going to hit me this time.
Okay. All right, so that is... that is 6 points of bludgeoning damage reduced to 3.
Cool, do wish I could have done that to the other one.
As The Warhammer swings into you, it cracks in, but you manage to twist just at the last moment to stop your ribs from being broken. The other three of them are going to pull out crossbows and take aim. One of them is going to take aim at Unimari, and two of them are taking aim at you, Willem. So against Unimari, that is a 13. You're muted, by the way. And against you...
Warding Flare?
Which one?
The one...
Just say first or second.
Just second.
Okay. That was the higher number. Okay, that's fine. So that would be a 18 to hit.
Miss.
And a 12 to hit.
Miss.
So, as both of them pull up towards you, Willona, the crossbows are loosed. One of them strikes against your shield. The other one, with a flash of light, it lets out this horrible cry as it is exposed as light for the first time in who knows how long. And just hands come up and its crossbows drop to its side for a moment. And as that happens, it distracts the one about to shoot at you, Namari, and as it looks at the side, the bolt slams into the ground next to you. Which will bring us to the top of the round again, brings us to Ronan.
Okay, so am I grappled here? Or
you're
was
not
I
grappled, pulled? But you're just being pulled.
Okay. Then I'll use my... No, I won't use my action to disengage, I'll just run away.
Okay.
I'll try and run to there.
All right. And get some attack for opportunity. That's a 26 to hit.
Oh, Jesus, yes.
All right, I'd like you to make a wisdom saving throw for me.
Ace. Oh, natural 19. Don't know what I've got as a modifier. Plus 4, 23.
Okay, yeah. All right, you're good. Uh, 22 points of damage, three of which is necrotic.
Yep.
And as it's the axe slams into you, you hear the wail of it, but you just push through and you're like, I gotta get away. As you charge away, just pulling the axe from you, this gout in the side. And that will end your turn?
Well, no, I want to use my attacks.
Oh, of course, yes.
I want to hit him in the face at okay. 20.
Was that a nat 20?
No, 10 plus 10.
All right, yeah. Yeah, that'll hit.
14, 19 on the first hit.
Okay.
And then the second bolt, it sat in a 20 and then it rolled in the 8. That's an 18.
That'll miss, unfortunately.
That's okay. Then, yeah, that's everything.
Okay, so the first bolt sinks deep into the creature's torso once again, but the second one pings off the shadowy form. That will end your turn, brings us to Tilly.
So I'm real spooked by the big old thing here, right?
Yes, you're currently frightened.
I can't move any closer to him, so I'm gonna bonus action disengage. I'm gonna leap back off this little ledge.
Okay.
Kinda use this little stone guy as a stepping stone and land behind him.
Okay.
Which I assume is like a good part of my movement.
Yep.
And then I will attack him with the claw.
Right. You have disadvantage.
For any particular reason?
You're frightened.
But it's only while he's in line of sight and there's a 10 foot drop there and I'm 3 foot tall.
He's also 12 foot. Yeah, he's also 12 foot tall.
So, well, that was a 2 on the first roll. So... that's 11 to hit.
That hits, just.
Wow, okay. Don't look a gift horse in the mouth. Oh, yeah. That is 11 slashing damage.
11 slashing damage, all right. So, as you just rake across these creatures' back with the claw, for the first time, one of them actually seems to show some form of pain, just reaching away from you from the force of this blow into its back. At the end of your turn, Grungil is going to use a second legendary action and is going to make a melee attack against someone in range, which is Yugun.
Bring it.
That is 15 to hit.
Nope.
No. So, as the axe comes round, you look up, bringing your blade, it catches it in the air. It's cling! As it reverberates through your hands, you just bear down. Let's try that again. You're being bared down by this creature. That will end your turn, Tilly. So that is the lair's go. And I can use that one. All right, so I need it. So that's two. So, I would like Ronan and Wilona to both make a strength saving throw as out from the darkness that surrounds you, two tendrils whip out towards you.
Eighteen.
Eighteen. All right. So as you bash this tendril to the sides as it comes close, Wilona. It snakes back around and whips back into the shadow. Ronan, you are grabbed by it, and you are pulled all the way across the room to one of the walls, are lifted 20 feet up in the air, and are restrained.
Cool. Okay. God damn it.
That will end the lair's go. Brings us to Tristan.
I would like to cast Fairy Fire on the thing and those two dudes.
Okay. You can do that. So that is
it's a dex save.
Thank you.
All right. So the guard next to Tilly, they will pass. However, the Fane and the other guard will both fail.
Nice.
With the Fane getting a 14 and the guard getting a 10. I assume they both fail.
Yeah, if they get a 16 or higher.
Okay, right. Gotcha.
And it's an action to inspect the lantern, I assume.
No, it's a bonus action.
Oh, it's a bonus. I'd like to inspect it.
I said it was a bonus, as a friend of Mari. So it's a bonus for you. Right, cool. So as you reach out your hand, and once again, you get that spray of glittery dust that encompasses the Fane and the guard. You, with the other hand up, pulling yourself up, trying to look inside where the lantern is. And once again, you see that the light coming out into you, which sort of, you know, blinds you for a moment, but you do see that shimmer from within it.
Hmm.
Get the fairy fire on there. That will end that go, which brings us to Bologna.
Sorry, had to unmute myself. So I'm going to I'm gonna try and keep the guard's attention by doing burning hands.
Burning hands. Okay.
Yes. Yeah. That is a dex save.
A dex save. Okay.
Yes.
A 7 and a 14.
My DC is 15.
So that's two fails.
Excellent.
What's the range on Burning Hands?
15 feet.
15 foot cone. All right. Yeah. So it will hit both. Yeah. Okay.
And 3d6. That is 8 points of fire damage.
8 points of fire damage. Okay. All right. Yeah. So as you put your hands together in a distinctive form, this golden fire lashes out from your fingertips, coursing all over the creatures. But once again, they do not seem to make any form of movement or motion from being attacked by this.
And what's your ruling for spells with bonus actions?
You can only cast one spell at a time.
Okay, just want to make sure. And then that will...
Unless it's a cantrip.
No, that will be my turn.
Okay. All right, and that will end your turn. Brings us to Grungil themselves. So they're going to step towards you, Gunn. You see the burning purplish darkness that is where their eyes used to be, fixated on you, brow furrowed in this glower, as he leans back and is just going to let out this horrible anguished cry. And I'm like, everyone in 30 feet, which is...
Oh boy.
You. You. So that is Gunn, Namari, Tilly and Tristan to make a dexterity saving throw, please.
Yeah. 15.
Okay.
I'm not even going to use inspiration for that.
No advantage in this one, gun, because danger sense.
Thank fuck. Hey, that's better. 16.
Dex save, did you say?
Yes, dex save, yeah.
15.
15?
Oh, no, 15, 25. I forgot.
It's a bit of difference.
Yeah, well, it was a 19 and it's a plus 6, and for some reason I just took a 10 away.
Okay, all right. So, four. Tilly?
15.
Okay. Gun?
16.
Sorry, memory shot. No way, you got Tristan. All right, so all of you apart from Damari passed, which means you all take a little bit of damage as opposed to a lot of bit of damage. Okay, so you take 9 points of damage reduced to 4 for everyone apart from Damari. And Damari, you're also not prone as he leans back and lets out this horrible this blast of shadow erupts out from him, catching all of you within it, and most of you manage to brace down, get out of the way of most of the action, but unfortunately you, Damari, are just caught by this wave as you're too busy switching your gaze back and forward between the creatures and the lantern. You look back just to see this blast of shadow just knock you off your feet. Okay. And that will end Grungil's turn, which brings us to Namari.
God, can I get back up?
You can, yeah. Take 15 feet of your movement.
And as a free action, look over to Tristan and say, did you see anything?
Can I reply or not?
Yeah, you can.
Lots of black swirls.
Same swirls as this guy, and then I attack the thing.
Okay, with
Eldritch Blast.
Eldritch Blast, all right.
That one is 16, and
that
the
will unfortunately miss.
Can I use inspiration for that, or should I call up first?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, you could have it before I called. You can use it now. I'll let you use it.
Okay. That's another 6, so... 16 plus 6, 22.
Yep, that
will. The other one will miss, unfortunately. Right. That is 9 plus 5, 14 damage.
14, and that's force damage, right?
Force damage, yes. Okay. All of it.
Okay. So, as one of the beams lances off and smashes into one of the stone pillars, breaking a chunk off of it, the second one careens into the creature's form and just, you see it all billows out for a moment.
Oh, sorry, is that fairy fire? Technically, I would have had advantage on ranged as well, right?
Oh, yes, yes.
Can I use one for a second, or is that too late?
Yeah.
Oh, thanks. That's 18 plus 8, so 26. Yeah, the other one hits as well. And that's another 9 plus 5 is 14.
Okay. All right. So that will end your turn, bringing us to Gun. This creature is in your face.
And I'm going to get in his kneecaps because I'm very small.
About that, yeah, but he's sort of slightly bent down towards you.
Well, either way, he's getting a sword shoved in him. And I get advantage, right? Because he's fairy fired.
Yes, you do. But you also get advantage because he's undead.
Do I get double advantage?
No.
Oh. Hey, I rolled 2 13s, which means that's a 23 to hit.
That will hit, yeah.
Ba-ba-da. Where's all my dices? 2d6, not d8, so why did I get d8s? 17 slashing on my first attack.
Okay.
And on my second, 21 to hit.
That will hit, yeah.
And 18 on the second.
18 on the second. right. So as both of your blows swing into this creature, you see your sword cut great rents into this creature's form, and you see that even though it is almost completely shadow, the cuts still remain there. Is just the creature does not seem to care at all that you've just carved two great swaths into its knees. And
I'm gonna try and do my thing. Needs to make a strength saving throw. I always forget I could do this.
Yes, you're gonna try and knock it backwards.
Yeah.
That's a natural one.
He gets pushed back 5 feet and I get to go, move, motherfucker, and punch him back and get in his space.
So as you slam into them with the hilt of your blade, it boom. Knocks them slightly, and as it does, it stumbles backwards. All right. And that will end your turn. And at the end of your turn, Grungle is going to once again use a Lash of Darkness legendary action, and the lash is going to come out, and I would like Tilly to make a strength saving throw.
I do not think that's very good. 8.
Unfortunately, you're not enough as the lash pulls you up onto the ledge once more.
Cool.
And that's the end of Guns Go, which means to the Guards Go. This guard's going to move around. This one's going to continue moving across. This one's going to move in like that. All right. And one's going to swing their Warhammer at you, Willona. That is going to be a 20 to hit.
Yeah, that'll hit.
All right. That's 7 points of damage. As the hammer just slams in, you try and brace it with your shield, but it cracks right into the weak point. And as it does, you feel your bone just buckle underneath the weight of it. One of them is going to hit you, Tilly. A 6 to hit?
No.
No. All right. And then one is going to shoot at you, Tristan. That's going to be 18 plus something to hit.
Yeah, that hits.
All right. So that's a heavy crossbow. So it's going to be 5 points of damage as this bolt catches you just above the shoulder and just scores off the top of the skin on that shoulder.
Lovely.
And that will end there, go. Which brings us to the top of the round again. Ronan.
Yeah, I want to try and break the grapple that's this tendril that's holding me up in the air.
Yep.
What do I roll for that?
You can repeat at the end of your turn to try and break it with a strength saving throw.
A strength save? Okay. Yeah, I'll give it a go.
Okay. You can still make attacks, I believe, while you're restrained. You just have
disadvantage. Yeah, they're at disadvantage. No, I'm going to try and break it. That's an 18 and a plus. Ooh, 20 total.
You can. It happens at the end of your turn, so you can. It's not like a grappled; it's a restrain effect. So.
Okay, I'll use my action to reload the crossbow while I'm there.
Okay, you're like being flung around against the wall by this creature. And what did you roll on your strength saving
throw? 20 total.
Okay, so as you finish reloading, you jam the butt of the crossbow into the tendril and start pushing it away. And as it does, it releases you, dropping you to the ground. You will take some falling damage.
It's fine.
You take 4 points of falling damage as you're broken against the sort of slight raised wall that rises up here, and you tumble down to the side. So you are prone.
Okay.
Wait, no, you're not. You don't fall far enough to be prone. All right. That will end your go, which brings us to Tilly.
Well, I've been kind of pulled out of my lovely, like, safe zone down there. Back up to the thing that I'm horrified of. Safe. So I'm gonna try and lash out at this statue thing.
All okay. Right. Obviously, I'm not frightened anymore. So.
So I have disadvantage, but it was verified, so that cancels out.
No, you don't have disadvantage.
Do I not?
No. You're not frightened anymore. You're only frightened until the end of your next turn.
Okay. Well, that was a nat 20 either way.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
I do have sneak attack because I have advantage.
Yeah, you have advantage. Yep.
Oh my god, all the dice.
All the dice.
Wow, that was 2 ones in that pool. But that's still a total of 18 slashing damage.
All right, so as you reach up into this creature, you stick the ends of the claw underneath the creature's helmet and just tear the front off of it. And as you do, this wispy piece of shadow just erupts from the top of it and the entire armor just crumples down to the floor.
Nice. I look a little bit more confident.
Okay. And you roll that d10.
That's a lot better than last time.
All right. And that will end your turn. Brings us to the lair action. And once again...
Just an attack. I have other stuff.
All right, okay.
Bonus to disengage. Get up next to gun.
Okay. All right. And then once again, the lantern begins to pulse once more outwards, and I would like...
That was foolish of me.
I would like Tilly, Gunn, Mari, and Tristan to all make a constitution saving throw, please.
Yeah.
13.
Also 13.
23.
Okay, so 13, 13, 23, 5. So you all succeed, apart from Namari, who takes an additional 8 points of necrotic damage, as once again you're wrecked by this. And then it's Tristan's go.
I would like to attempt to blind the thing. It's a con save, so I feel like it's going to be good at them, but you never know.
Okay. That is an 18.
Damn it, he saves.
All right. So, as you attempt to blind it, you just see the Fane's eyes turn and lock with you. And at the end of your turn, it's going to take a legendary action and lash of its second legendary action and a lash of darkness against you. So I'd like you to make a strength saving throw, please, Tristan.
Ooh, that's going to be a straight roll. It's a 7.
A 7. So you are dragged through the form of the Fane, and for a moment you are filled with this incredible sense of loss, despair. For a moment you fully understand what this Fane went through, this longing for any form of contact. And then you're on the other side of the Fane, and the eyes once again turn to look at you, these spots of purplish darkness staring down. And that would be Lona's turn.
All right, so I'm going to use my action to disengage.
Okay.
And I would like to climb up this wall.
All right. Make an athletics check for me.
I will do that. Wish me luck. Oh, that's not bad. That's not bad. So that would be an 18.
So as you try to clamber up this wall, this sheet stone wall is just, there's just nothing to grip on for you, and as you try to reach for the surface, it's just too far and you tumble back down again.
Oh man, all right, so that was bad shit. Okay, well, we'll just
sheet stone walls with no handholds are hard to climb.
Move over is that gonna take any of my movement?
No, we'll say no.
That'd be nice. 5, 10, 15. Gonna come over here and hey Ronan, you okay?
I'm badly beat up.
Which brings us...
Was that my action then?
You've got your bonus action.
Okay, I'm going to use my bonus action then to cast Shield of Faith on him.
Okay.
So he gets a +2 to his AC.
+2 to AC. All right. And that will bring us to Grungil, who's going to see if he gets his cry back. Does not. All right. In that case then, each creature within 5 feet, which is all three of you, automatically takes 2 points of necrotic damage.
I should have just run away.
And it's going to make an attack against you, Tristan, an attack against you, Gunn. So against you, Tristan, that is a 20, not natural.
Put in words, that would be lovely.
Okay. Go for it.
I just shout knock knock as though I'm starting a joke, and I will never finish the joke, just to really frustrate him.
All right.
But at least that's the attempt.
Got him. Oof.
Yeah.
Got him there. Zinger.
I mean, it's already really annoying me.
6 on the dice, so that brings it down to from a 20. to a 14, that still hits.
Wait, isn't you only on, are you only on D6s?
Well, it's cutting words, it's the Bardic Inspiration dice, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, then it's a D8, so I could have
Right, okay. D8 now. Oh.
Yeah, as of this level.
Oh right, okay. So that still hits. And yeah. Against you, Gun, that's 30 to hit.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah, that's gonna do it.
So, Tristan, mm-hmm. you take 27 points of slashing damage and 5 points of necrotic damage.
That's a concern.
Ooh. So
that is 32 Ooh. Points of damage in total.
I was on 33.
Ooh.
So as the axe just slams into you, it catches you in the middle of your torso, smacking you into the pillar next to you, barely clinging to consciousness. You grip against your torso, your abdomen area now, which is just spilling blood as these purpley tendrils of this dark energy that surrounds the axe continue to just creep up your form, this inviting death. Against Yugen. Oh, I rolled 2 12s. So that's 29 points of slashing damage, reduced to half, which is 15.
Mm-hmm.
And 5 points of necrotic damage, which is not reduced. So that's 20 points of damage in total.
Ouch.
And I would like both of you to make wisdom checks, please.
Please don't run away and leave me here.
Wisdom saving throws, sorry.
Natural 20. So 21.
Nice.
0?
Okay, so Tristan, as you manage to fight off the fear of this creature, despite the fact that you're almost completely dead, as the axe slams into Yugen, it fills your mind full of ideas of this happening to your home, to your family, and you watch as in the split second in your mind, it shows this happening to every single dwarven hold, and you see in an instant the entire destruction of your species, and that fills you with dread to your core. You're frightened until the end of your next turn.
Nice.
And that will end Grungil's turn, which brings us to Namari.
Now, did I see Tristan get essentially taken through him, through the thing?
Yeah, you saw this sort of lash, this tendril of darkness reach out and yank Tristan through the air and through the fane, and then you saw this slam and you heard of the axe and you saw the pillar shake slightly.
Is the thing still sort of misty?
Yes.
Could I misty step into him? I know it says unoccupied space.
It's sure.
I want to misty step into him, which is a bonus action, and movement-wise it works. And yes. Then invoke Fey Presence Charm.
Okay.
And say, please stop. We were friends once, protectors. You called us your own. Stop.
Okay. So you're going to take the full front of his harrowing form. Which, that's a hard word to say, which is 8 points of necrotic damage. And your words seem to fall on completely deafened ears.
Awesome. Isn't that a 10-foot cube?
It's creatures of your choice in a 10-foot cube, I believe.
Yeah. So he passed the save?
No, he's immune to charmed.
Fuck's sake.
Yeah. All right. Would you like to do anything else? As you're currently inside the creature, and there's the shadowy form which makes up this creature, is just racking you with pain.
Well, then I'm moving, stepping out.
Okay.
At least.
That will end your turn, which brings us to Gun.
I am afeared, so what can I do?
So you can't move any closer to the creature, which doesn't make any difference at this point. And you have disadvantage on all attacks against the creature. However, you have advantage.
So it cancels out, just be straight attack.
But then you also have a second instance of advantage.
So I have advantage again?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I'll fucking hit him then. For all his past transgressions. 22 to hit.
That does hit.
That is 17 slashing damage.
Okay.
And then 25 with 16.
Okay.
And I can't push him because he'll knock Namari over.
Well, just push into Namari again.
I didn't agree to be a part of that scene, so no.
I'm perfectly healthy with my 7 hit points.
As your blade strikes into the creature once again, now you see the form still bears no seeming difference to it, apart from the fact that you are cutting deep into it. And that will end your turn. Right? Would you like to do anything else with it?
I can't do anything else.
All right, which will bring us to the guards. This one moves down here. This one moves up like that. This one is going to move up. All right. So this bottom guard is once again going to pull out its crossbow and take a shot against you, Namari. One's going to hit you, Gun, and the one's going to hit you, Belena. So against you, Belena. All right. That was a 6 to hit. Against you, Gun, that's a 6 to hit. And against you, Namari, well, it's a 16 to hit.
Oh yeah.
And that is 4 points of damage as the crossbow bolt sinks into you. And at the end of the Fug's turn, the guard's turn, Grungil is going to use fluid movement to move maximum distance, which is over here, and does not provoke any attacks opportunity in doing so.
Dicks.
And that will end that, which brings us to the top of the round again, which is Ronan. So this wall in front of you, Ronan, you would give 3/4 cover to the Fane if you were trying to shoot them right now.
Okay.
You can still see due to the Fane's height.
Yeah, I'll see the guard attack of Valona, and I'll do you have this?
Yeah.
I will use my movement to move 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 along the wall.
Yeah.
How high is that wall?
This wall here is sort of, this one here is a, it's like a ceremonial, like, plinth wall. So it's not that high, it's a couple of feet.
Okay. Well then, if it's a couple of feet, I was at this point. Can I just clamber over it?
This wall, yeah. No, this wall here is a full length wall. I thought you were talking about this wall here. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So I can get to here, and I can shoot at the thing freely now.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. I will take my attacks against the thing.
Go for it.
24.
That will hit.
That'll be, oh, that's 70, 90, 24 points of damage.
Okay.
And then second bolt, I will actually try and hit the one, this guard here. I'm gonna try to spread the DPS.
Yeah, go for it.
24 to hit.
That does hit, yeah.
And I only have my 10 points of damage. No
10 points of damage.
Right. Hunter's Mark, no Colossus Slayer.
Okay, so you strike into the Fane, and as the bolt hits in, you hit the center of the creature's torso, and as the bolt sinks in, it begins to spill forth with this purplish light from within, the same purplish light from within the lantern, and as it does, you see now the inside the creature's chest cavity, inside the fane's, where the fane's heart should be, you see this point of light has just blossomed forward.
Is that on, if that's on the first hit, can I aim the second hit towards him instead? If that would have been the,
sure,
that was like a reroll?
Yeah, go for it.
Okay. Natural 20. Hands all up, right. I'm off it. Natural 20.
Okay.
So that's 9, 18, 20, 25.
Okay. So as the bolt sinks in, you see this point of light shifts in the fane's torso as this bolt slams into it and knocks it and shifts it down in the creature's torso. As it moves towards a different point.
Okay.
And that will end your go. At the end of your go, Grungil is going to use second legendary action to once again do a lash of darkness, and is going to use it on you, Malona. So I would like you to make a strength saving throw.
Alrighty. Oh no! That's an 8.
Okay, so you are dragged into melee range of the creature, slammed into the wall and spun head over heels as you do, landing right next to Grungil. And that brings us to Tilly.
This like point of light, it moved. Can we still see it?
Yeah, you can still see it shining through the form of the creature.
Okay. Is it like in hittable height?
For you?
Considering that I can leap vertically 9 feet.
With a running jump, sure.
Well, I've got plenty of run up, so I will take the attack of opportunity. Actually, no, I can disengage. What am I talking about? I can bonus to disengage.
Yes, you can.
And I am going to attack him. Okay. I believe I have flanking here, technically.
Yes.
Which is +2, right?
Yes.
Okay.
You also get sneak attack.
I'm probably not. Oh, I still have an advantage, right?
No, it's not. Well, you have advantage. From yes, because of fairy fire. Yeah.
Okay, thank God.
Oh, actually, Tristan, before you give that advantage, sorry, Tristan, you need to roll a concentration check. Because you took, like, 30 damage. Yeah. So.
Concentration, that's constitution, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's going to be an 8.
Okay, so no fairy fire, so no advantage.
19 to hit still.
19 to hit. That will, at this point, on the point of light, not hit.
Oh, really? Damn.
So as you reach up, go to grab for it, it's just out of your reach. The claw nicks the edge of it, but you tumble to the ground.
Crap.
Would you like to do anything else with your turn?
That's everything.
Okay. So at the end of your turn is the lair again, and out from the shadow, two more guards step. Seemingly coalescing from nothingness, these two guards walk out of the shadow, crossbows in hand. And that will end their turn, which brings us to Tristan.
I would like to cast Dissonant Whispers using the Ring of Arcane Harmony to give him disadvantage.
Okay, all right.
Level 3 as well, just so we know. Like, I'm going ham on this because I've got 1 hit point.
At level 3, okay. So I rolled a 13 and a 15, and this is what?
Wisdom.
So that is the lower roll. Makes it a 15.
And it needed to be a 16.
So it takes,
it takes 5d6 psychic damage.
All right. Psychic damage.
I think it's psychic damage.
Yeah.
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 I'll just double check.
Okay.
Yeah, psychic damage. So 5d6.
Ooh.
Points of psychic damage. 21 points,
yeah.
And I feel like it's immune to being frightened, but if it's not, it's frightened and has to use its reaction to move.
How many points was that, sorry?
21.
21, okay. All right. It's unfortunately immune to being frightened, yeah. But you see as now the creature reaches up and holds its hands to their head, you notice as soon as this point of light has been revealed, the motions have got a lot more human or a lot more living to the creature, less roboticized. Which brings it to the end of your turn, and it's, which means it's to Verona.
So I'm going to unfortunately drop Ronan's plus two with the Shield of Faith because I'm going to cast Spirit Guardians.
Okay. Let me bring up the Spirit Guardians graphic.
And they're absolutely going to be angelic.
Yep.
And I would like to designate my my party members to not be affected by it.
That's 20 feet, isn't it?
15.
15, okay. Is it 15 feet radius?
Yes.
Oh, so that's a lot bigger than that. That's that.
Yeah.
And it doesn't center on you because of the size. No.
But yeah.
Yeah. Oh, well.
That's all I've got, though.
You get where it is.
Yeah.
Oh, wrong layer. it's there. Okay. All right. So that will end your turn, which brings us to Grungil, who starts his turn with the Spirit Guardians. So,
right, 3d8.
Is it a saving throw, or is it just damage?
I believe there is a saving throw, and I think it is... Wisdom.
Wisdom. Okay. That's a 20, not natural.
Yeah, that's nice. Wow. All right, so that is 7 points halved.
Okay. Yes. So, as these winged forms slash towards the creature, it carves across, but doesn't seem to do nearly as much damage as you were thinking, like, even less than you were expecting. Okay, so... Does... Okay, in that case then, Grungil is going to let out another anguished cry, so everyone within 30 feet... Actually, Grungil's going to move first.
Oh.
Yeah, there you go.
An attack of opportunity?
Yes.
Excellent.
It's not from me as well, is it? Because he stayed in my range?
Stayed in your range and moved through you.
Ouch.
Mm-hmm. I have a feeling that's going to miss...
What is it?
It is an 11.
Yeah, that misses.
Yeah.
Your mace swings out. It does not seem to impact it. So that is everybody has to succeed on a dexterity saving throw, please.
Ooh. 17.
16.
Okay. 8. Double digits would be nice with these 26. One day.
Would be nice.
Okay. Natural 1.
Ooh, 19.
Okay. So, Ronan and Namari, you both unfortunately fail, which means you take the full damage, which is 12 points of necrotic damage.
And I fall to the ground.
And you're both knocked prone if you're not already on the ground. So you're knocked prone.
Mm-hmm.
Namari is out of there, and everybody else that passed it, you take half damage, which means 6 damage to each of the rest of you.
Oh, I'm done then.
Team half elf, woo!
Sorry, I was about to cast heroism on both of us as well. No. We'd have been immune to frightened and get 5 temp hit points.
Oh.
I'd have still gone down though, but oh well.
And that will end Grungil's turn. Both Tilly and Willona should have taken damage from Harrowing Fall. Tilly and Willona both take 3 points of necrotic damage.
Cool.
Alright, and that will end Grungil's turn, which brings us to Namari. Okay, so that's a pass. Which brings us after you. Grungil is going to use a legendary action to make a melee attack against you, Tilly.
Sweet.
That's a 27 to hit.
Mm-hmm.
Would you like
to go ahead and uncanny dodge this?
Okay. That's 22 points of damage, reduced to 11.
Cool.
As the axe slams into you. And that will bring us to Gunn's turn. Gunn.
Right. I'm going to shove my sword into the guy in front of me.
Okay.
Is he fairified or anything like that?
No, but you do have advantage.
The 22 to hit.
That does hit.
Ba-ba-ba-ba. 14 slashing on him.
Okay. Just tears through the creature, just crumples to the ground.
I will use the momentum. I'm going to pretend like I did a really cool sweet flip boom, with the sword, and then use that momentum to charge forward and hit this guy.
Okay.
Can I aim for the point of light? Is yes. it too high? Oh, sweet. So I'm going to give him the old slasheroo.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I rolled 2 19s. What the? Okay, 29 to hit.
That does hit.
17 slashing.
17 slashing. Good. How do you want to do this?
I want a shadow of the Colossus, this shit.
Okay. I know exactly what you mean. So, as you carve down the creature, just sort of carving this, as you carve the guard in two, it's two parts falling side to side. You charge through the remains, they barely hit the ground before you battered through them. And as you do, you reach out, grabbing onto the what little physical form remains of the fane, pulling up the blade, sticks in, and you use it to drag yourself up. And with the final blow, you bring the blade straight into this point of light. And as it cuts deep through it, the purple light is replaced by this orange, warm glow. And everything goes silent. All sounds seemingly evaporated from the room as the glow expands and expands and expands, and as the Fane's face turns towards you, this horrified expression on your face, and as the light expands and touches the head, the expression softens into one of gratitude before the form begins to burn away, flickering off like pieces of golden ash, leaving you to fall to the ground momentarily, your sword clattering next to you as the pierced through ball of light fades and dissipates. Around you now, the darkness seems to abate slightly, returning to a much more normal level. And the silence once again vanishes. And you can hear the gentle sounds of the mountain creaking once more underneath.
And then you hear clanking as Milana runs over to the half-elves to go, oh my god, oh my god, oh my god.
Ting, 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 ting,
I'm going to cast Cure Wounds at first level on both of them.
Okay. And as you do that, we're going to take a quick break because your DM needs to be right back. Okay. All right. So getting right back into it, as the supernatural darkness lifts and is now just regular darkness, the form of the Fane has completely vanished, leaving behind only the axe and the lantern, which sits now still giving off that sickly purplish light on its pedestal.
Well, I'm going to grab the axe.
Okay.
Makes sense.
As you look over the axe, you see as it was once a proud and mighty rune axe, one of the blades of the Fanes. However, much of the brass and bronze reliefs have been corroded away. The edge of it is dulled and in parts broken. And these cracks of purplish energy spread across the axe head, and you see they pulse ever so slightly with the same purplish light as the lantern. And all of the ancient dwarven runes which line the axe have faded and are completely inert. But you hold it in your hands, it still seems magical.
Cool, I'm gonna... I'm going to pitch it at the lantern.
Okay.
Like, you know, do the spinny throw.
All right, make an attack roll.
Do I get advantage?
If you reckless attack.
I'm going to recklessly attack the lantern.
I'm sure it will recklessly attack you back.
What do I add to this?
It's a great axe. So add what you currently add for your greatsword, minus
one. Okay, 27.
Okay, so as it spins through the air, it hits the lantern, and you see the lantern ting, 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 on top of the pedestal before poof, it falls off and starts rolling along the ground.
I don't know too much about all this lantern business, so I'm going to climb up on that throne and take a breather. That was a lot of dodging.
Sit on the throne. So it's a little big for you, but not as big as most normal chairs are.
Cool. I'm a chill.
Are Tristan and Amari still dead?
No.
We're up.
Both of them have been awoken by Willow.
Yeah, I let them know what they got.
Okay. Right, I'm going to go over to the lantern then. On the floor.
Yeah. You hop down the 10-foot drop.
What's the lantern like? Is it just on the floor? Not damaged or anything?
Not damaged, just on the floor.
All right, I'll go pick the axe up. Okay. Worth a shot. So, we have the lantern.
Can I look through the High Tinker's journal to see if there's anything that mentions the actual creation of this one particular? Like, because they were going on about the giant one.
It's mostly creation notes. It's like things like it's a bronze adamantium alloy. The lantern was designed to the Fane specifications, including all of the different reliefs on it. The fact that the size of it, size descriptions, things like that. There seems to be no method, like no describing of what's on the inside of the lantern, or how you get on the inside of the lantern.
I'm gonna walk over and also inspect the lantern and see if maybe with my blacksmith history, maybe I could find a way to get into it.
Sure, make a blacksmithing check with intelligence.
Can I give her advantage because I also know about smithing?
Sure.
Baller. So those were 18 and 19. I don't have a plus anything for intelligence.
But you do add your proficiency bonus.
Right, so that would be...
22.
Yes.
Okay, so the construction of this lantern is impeccable. All of the welds are on the inside so that they can't be broken from the outside.
That's interesting.
There's no form of any bolts or rivets on the outside. It's completely smooth. It looks like the majority of it is constructed from one singular sheet of metal that's been bent round.
Hmm.
And to give a better picture of what this looks like, it almost looks like a birdcage, but much more like a sheet of iron that's sort of like in a bell shape, with holes cut into it. And each of these holes is a sort of a different part of the relief that's all over the front of this. So when it shines out in various different shapes that are like an axe, a dwarf of an axe over the head, or what have you, you know, like a set of mountains.
And the holes are filled with like glass or something, I assume.
No, you can see straight in. But they're all like very small, so like it's kind of hard to get stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
Has anyone picked up the diadem?
The diadem?
The diadem's gone.
Oh, it's gone. Right.
It's gone, yeah.
No, I'd have that shit.
Just checking. That doesn't remember it being mentioned.
I'm the Thane now. Oops.
I mean, you have the Thane's diadem.
Yeah.
You took it off the Thane's body. There's no door that you came in through. Currently. There's just shadowy blackness. You can't see any of the far walls of any of the room, apart from the back of the room, behind the throne, where there is a large set of double doors.
Hey, gun.
Hmm.
A very, very big key hole in them.
Do you still have that piece of that broken anvil?
Yeah.
Do you think maybe this would react to it or no? Just a thought.
It's worth a shot.
I'm guessing nothing will happen, but like, you know, if there's some kind of magical thing.
I'm adventure gaming it. Rub the thing on the thing.
You're just getting everything out of your pack one by one. Banana? No.
Crunch.
I'm going to wander off and look at these double doors while people are messing with this lantern.
Okay. This keyhole is so large, Tilly, that you could walk inside it.
So you're saying I could go in and mess with the mechanism and yes. unlock it? I'd like to do that.
Till it becomes the lockpick.
Yeah,
this is like the weirdest visual.
So as you pull yourself up and into this keyhole, which is you, it's funny because you've got your head aligned to it. You walk inside this keyhole, and you enter the hole. Inside is this complex work of gears, of pivots. You see pulleys and chains. And I would like you to make a lockpicking check.
Okay, I have proficiency on that, right?
Yes.
What attribute is it?
A dexterity for that. Actually, no, intelligence for this one.
Tilly's very smart. That's something you'd know if you've met Tilly.
Tilly's such a tool right now.
Wow.
16. Yeah.
Okay, you're in the inside of this, you're like, oh, it's really big in here.
This isn't the perspective I'm used to picking locks from.
Yeah, you're like, this doesn't look like the, I imagine, the inside of a lock to look. And you pick up a small pebble from inside your pouch. You just throw it into one of the gears and it goes clank, 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 and breaks off. And then more bits start breaking until you feel something clunk underneath you. And you almost knocked off your feet as the door swings open slightly.
I imagine everyone else hears that.
Yeah, you hear this cacophony of tang, tong, tang, tonk, kank. And then Tilly's like, whoa. She's almost knocked off her feet.
Where's Tilly? Oh.
something, Luca?
I just kind of dust myself off. I've opened the door. So much for that dwarven engineering gun.
I'm just saying, if it was from my hold, you won't get that open.
They should make that lock smaller.
Well, you know, dwarven holds aren't usually
goblins.
No. Yeah, goblins ain't smart though. Wait, Tilly, shit. Never mind. Point retracted. You win this one.
Do you think a goblin is smarter than Tilly?
The entire time Gunn's doing this, just Tristan's eyebrow just gets higher and higher and higher. Just not engaging, just accepting.
Enjoying the moment.
Yep. Holding wow. together my chest. It's like, yep. Yep.
The way is open.
But I don't think we can do much with this lantern right now, at least. How big is it?
How about your height?
Oh, fuck.
You can carry it.
I mean, at this point, I'm just strapping everything to me from this place and bringing it with me. So fucking let's fashion a backpack. I'll carry the lantern as well. Why not?
That's like that can roll well.
It can roll.
We could roll it.
It's round.
No, because that's really mean for the thing inside it. Like in a washing machine.
Only if it doesn't keep up.
Yeah, and also, it seems that whatever these lanterns were maybe had a hand in what was corrupting the dwarves, so maybe carrying around the biggest one that was sought after by the Thane might not be the best idea.
Mm.
Maybe leaving it where we know where it's supposed to be.
We saw celestial creatures being put in them, right, Stuart?
Mm-hmm. Yes, in the visions.
Like, and clearly angelic-looking doodads.
Not angelic, celestial.
That's why I connect celestial to in my head.
But it's not the same thing.
That's incorrect, though, isn't it?
Yes. I mean, angels are a form of celestial, but these aren't angels.
Unicorns are also celestial. Oh, what if there's a unicorn in that lantern? Oh, man. Now I'm sad.
So
what's the plan? We should rest before we go swanning off anywhere else.
Would
actually
be nice.
That is a very good point. Plus I want to check out this shiny new axe. Look at this, guys.
Collecting axes.
I was gonna say,
they're very important
to
my
queen.
People. Losing them rather quickly, but there's all these new axes for you.
Look, it's a dwarven thing you wouldn't understand.
That is
if you love an axe, let it go.
I've let many go in a very short span of time, so please. The wound is still fresh.
Yeah, I can see, actually.
Speaking of fresh wounds.
Yeah.
Mm. Ow.
Yeah, we should.
Let's roll some 8 dice. And
so you're all taking a short rest.
Fuck yes.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
During that period, you are attuned to the axe.
I'm just going to use all of them.
Say hello.
I have many left.
That. And as you sit there, Tilly, you once again hear a voice in your head.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
That should have been your kill. Do better next time.
Again, trying my best to compartmentalize this voice and ignore it.
Mm-hmm.
Probably take that gauntlet off for a little while.
Mm-hmm.
Are you doing a song of rest, Jamie?
I am. I was going to say everyone gets 4.
Oh, tight.
All right. Okay. What's up?
No, I'm just reading my new toy.
Toy's fun. I assume yours doesn't come with a nasty voice.
Yours has a voice?
That was out of character.
Aaron wasn't doing their Tilly voice, which is just Aaron's voice, but slightly higher and with a slight stammer to it.
Quite exasperated.
Yeah. No, that's just Aaron.
Oh.
Usually more pain.
So, as you finish bandaging up some wounds, looking over your fancy new axes, getting spoken to in your head, what would you like to do heading forward now? Great axe is a
d12. Well, we got a big old pair of doors to go through.
Yeah. Also, Tilly, at least we didn't get bitten this time.
True.
It's slashing.
I figured, thank you.
Yeah, should we try to find our way out then?
It looks like we have one place to stop.
Right.
I guess I'll lead the way.
Okay. Who's what's happening with a lantern?
Is there anything else in the room that relates to the lantern other than the pedestal it was on?
Not that you can see, no.
Right. Has anyone actually looked at the pedestal?
No.
No.
Okay. I'll have a look at that before we go then.
It's ornately carved out of stone, sweeps up into the top. It's heavy, it's thick. It's one solid piece sheet of stone. It's got no obvious markings or anything on it.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe I don't know. It's confusing me.
Well, I mean, we could even just seal this entire thing off.
Yeah, but if there is something trapped inside it,
probably wants to.
I mean,
out.
It's been there for a long time. If it has, but
yeah,
I don't know.
Don't know how to get into it. That's incredible work, like craftsmanship. So
I think we should leave it here for the time being.
Yeah.
Carry on ones, and once we know what to do, come back for it. I take off my new fancy cloak that I bought to get me up the mountain, and I just put it over the lantern anyway. I'm just like, meh.
How do we know there's going to be an easy way back here?
Where are we even? I don't.
The bridge was broken, was it not?
Well, yes, but then we were many places.
I could take it and see if there's someone who might know what to do with it.
Can we open the door and just see what's behind where we are exactly?
Yeah. So you go up and you push open doors. Behind, there lies a room lit by ever-burning torches, seemingly pushing back the darkness to a small extent. Within, you see piles of gold coins. Ancient vases littered the area, some of them broken, but a few remain. A pair of heavy diamonds and a set of doors at the other end of the room. You see large compartments in the walls, now empty, or the chests that were within them pulled out and scattered on the floor, their golden contents littering. But you stand within the vaults.
Tristan? Get back.
Mm-hmm. I want to sit down for a second, take out my book, and... You're busy inspecting these items, I'm assuming.
Mm-hmm.
Cast detect magic as a ritual.
Okay. You see the magic, which is the 6 points of light with the 6 braziers mounted on the walls, that is the ever-burning torches. Aside from that, you see no magic in here.
I don't think any of the items are cursed or anything. It should be fine.
I'm just going to go lay on all the gold.
Yeah.
Just... Yeah. As you were saying that, I had both the diamonds in my hand. Like, well, that's good to know.
The diamonds are about the size of your palm. It's like a decent sort of lime-sized diamond.
Even better.
2 of them.
So I assume we could fit a decent amount of this gold into the bag of holding, if not all of it.
Probably all of it.
I like that probably. That means there's a lot.
Sounds like a challenge.
Would you like to spend some time putting all of the gold in the bag?
I would.
Okay. Are you counting it in or are you shoveling it in?
How long would it take roughly as a count?
About a short rest length.
Okay.
For God's sake.
I'd rather know how much is going in personally.
We can count it when we're not in a terribly cursed dwarven hole.
It's also true.
Things that want to kill us lurking behind every door.
I start mage hand shoving things in while he's still.
Okay, so these piles and piles of gold, some of them as tall as Tilly, are just shoveled into this. Are you putting just everything that's in here in the bag?
What else is in? You said that there's vases as well.
There's some vases,
gold,
and diamonds. Okay. The empty chests, but they're just chests.
Okay. Is there anything other than the gold and the diamonds? Any items as such?
Yeah, can I give a look over now?
I mean, you can, but it's all in plain sight.
Okay.
Once all of the gold has been moved away, there's not much left. There's a couple of unreachable pieces of gold that have fallen between like flagstones.
Mage hand.
It's too far down. Sorry. No mage hand ledger dermin for you.
Gun, I don't know if these vases have any cultural significance.
And yet, here you are looting them. Funny.
I wasn't looting them specifically. I was trying to see whether or not they would have some sort of cultural significance to your people or the memory of the people that belonged here.
Just the inherent gold value.
They're just they're elvish vases.
Oh, they're elvish. All right, sweet. Let's have them.
Wow. What it must be like having no respect for your own culture.
Yikes.
Guilt free.
I mean, it depends on what your culture treats you like, to be fair.
Mm-hmm. How many of those vases were there?
Four. And at this point, the bag is getting mighty hefty in terms of how much is in it.
About that gun carrying everything.
Oh, no, I have the bag.
I know, but can you carry it?
Yeah, you can, but it's starting to look a bit full.
Mm.
Yeah. So.
Were the next set of doors locked as well, or were they?
They're not locked. They look incredibly thick. They are completely plain stone that are sort of slightly worn away at the edges.
Well, I guess we start heaving those open.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Let's do it.
As soon as you put your hands on them to push, you can feel they're cold, incredibly cold. And you push them open, immediately you're hit by the very first push you hear. As you push them open, as you continue to push, they open and you're met by a blast of wind and snow. As you push the doors open onto the side of a mountain.
Like the literal side of a mountain, or is there something we can walk out onto?
A mountaintop. There's a path that winds up.
The creatures being forced into the lantern, what environment was that? Where do we saw it happening?
That looked like it was in the Circle Call.
Right, well, I'm going to sprint back real quick and go get my cloak. So I don't fucking freeze to death.
Okay.
I mean, I guess we can come back for the lantern.
Yeah, we are really leaving this here after all we went through to get here.
I think I'm going to take it.
Do you want to carry the thing the size of me on a mountainside?
I could roll it down.
All right. It did seem pretty sturdy.
All right.
I just hope the thing inside it doesn't mind banging and banging.
Well, I didn't mean just, you know, poof off the mountainside. I meant, you know, like controlled rolling.
Oh, okay.
I mean, it's been locked in darkness. Then I hope it doesn't get seasick.
Zero strength, but if necessary, I'll help Willona with that. I don't think we should leave it here.
I can whistle a jaunty tune.
To inspire me.
Mm-hmm. Potentially.
It doesn't take a check to roll it.
Yeah, I would try to at least get it to the daylight, see if that would do anything.
It's nighttime outside currently.
Oh, well, damn it.
So, as you run back to get your coat, gun. Mm-hmm. As you pull it off the lantern, the light has dulled significantly.
Mm.
It starts flickering slightly.
Can I see inside it better now?
You look inside and still that sort of white out on the inside of it, with just that shimmer. Except it's not a white out, it's like a purple out.
All right. Then I guess we just take it to the snow.
Okay, so you're rolling it outside. So, as you roll it back up, and you get to the outside, you see now that you're on the edge of a mountainside. You're actually on the western edge of the mountainside right now. The tall kneeling spire carries up next to you, and you see the path begins to wind up the side of the mountain. And this path is being carved into the mountain, but it's obviously constructed. You can see the remains of stone braziers in the side of the mountain. Some of them collapsed over, others just worn away or covered in snow. It's very windy and snowy up here right now. But the snow is fresh.
Which is exactly what we came here for, right?
Yeah.
This is true. I collect some of the snow.
Okay. You put it in the special vial.
Mm-hmm. And I'm also actively staying away from the lantern.
Okay.
Just because.
You said there was a path, right?
Mm-hmm.
Guess that's the way to go then.
All right. So, as you keep arcing upwards, going round and round and round, you notice that clouds are currently obscuring the moon. It's dark out here. You can't see the stars or anything. Even though you're above the first layer of clouds, there's a second layer above you. It's dark. You can see nothing below you as there's the first layer of clouds is there. As you go round, round and up and up. Journey is hard. It's very cold out here, but you make it through. It's nothing compared to what you've been through in the past couple of days. And eventually, the path begins to even out as you reach the summit, the top of this spire. As you round the final corner, you're met by a small remnant of an archway. Beyond it lies a great stone platform, round, on which sit a number of chairs. 7 in total. You see the first on the left-hand side around the sort of in a horseshoe shape. The first is a small stone seat chiseled in the sculpting methods of the dwarves. You see the angular forms, the channels. Next to it, you see a seat which is oddly not covered in any snow or anything. It is wooden, covered in moss and lichen. Next to it, you see a simple stony outcropping that seems to jut from the ground, forming the simple shape of a chair. To the next to it is a throne that is hard-edged, made of cold granite, covered in a permafrost that seems to encase the entire thing in a thin layer of ice. Next to it, a dark metal seat that singes every time a droplet of snow hits it. Which burns off instantaneously. Next to that, you see a seat completely made of glass. It refracts the little light that you can see around it. And finally, a marble seat. Each of these seats is progressively taller than the last, and this marble seat sits at the opposite edge of the dwarven one, edged in gold and bottomed with barnacles, a small moat around the bottom of it. In the center of it is a table.
What does it say at the bottom of the marble chair?
It has barnacles. There's no inscriptions or anything. It's barnacles and a moat.
Oh, right. Sorry, I thought you said note. It sounded like note with an N.
A moat, as in like a... it's got water around it.
Just to recap what the chairs were, there was a stone one, the wooden one covered with moss.
Yep.
There was a metal one and the marble one. What were the others?
So it's stone chair, mm-hmm. mossy wooden chair, mm-hmm. stony outcrop in the shape of a chair.
Right.
A very hard edge permafrost covered chair, dark metal chair, a glass one, and the marble one.
I can make a pretty good guess what these are to do with. Tilly can't. Tilly most definitely cannot.
Is this something dwarven, I ask Gunn? Do you have...
Make a history check with disadvantage.
Oh, boy. Guidance.
Hey, so that's a D4, right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. 16.
You identify that the smallest chair is definitely of dwarven make. It's the same that you've seen. It's similar in shape to actually the famous one you saw below. And you know that the horseshoe is a shape often used in dwarven terms to mean meetings between various different people of high rank. The gathering of fanes, which happens in the High King's Hall, the shape they sit in is the horseshoe as well. But you're not sure who exactly this was made for.
I'm gonna try and like roll the lantern onto like the table just to give it a place to sit.
Okay, so you roll it and heave it up onto the table. It sits in the center now.
I mean, this is very obviously a meeting place, but for who, I don't know.
I don't want to look inside the lantern again and maybe knock on the side and sit. And just sort of sighingly sit. Good. If you could just tell us how we can get you out of there.
I'm trying to think of any like fictional reasoning I might know the thing that I know.
There's no fictional reasoning. I think we already established that no one knows about the thing. That I know that you as Aaron know what it is, because Aaron's been here before.
I'm gonna go sit on the mossy chair and chill.
Okay.
Yeah, Gunn would sit in the dwarven one.
I want to touch the hot one.
Okay. It's warm to the touch.
Oh, okay.
Sit in it. This feels nice. It feels like hammered metal. It's like it's not long come out of a fire, a forge.
This feels like home.
I'd like to inspect the glass one.
Okay. There's no obvious seams or anything to this glass chair. It's literally a single structure of glass. It refracts things in a very prismatic way.
Tragically, there's no swamp chair for Ronan.
Well, there's one with barnacles.
Yeah.
True.
That's the marble one, right?
Yeah. King Ronan.
Is there anything interesting about the table as well?
It's round. It's very small. Has nothing on it. Well, that's a lie. Has a lantern on it now. But it had nothing on it before the lantern was put on it.
No markings or anything like that?
No markings. There's a small channel in the floor from the center of each of seat thrown to the table. But no markings, no...
So lamp. Something either runs from or towards the chairs, from or towards...
It's not an angled channel. Right. It's like everything is pointing towards this table.
Right, okay.
I wonder why somebody would put this at the summit of a ridiculously cold mountain.
Maybe something that lives up in mountains met here.
Are any of the chairs magical to the touch?
I mean, the fact that none of them are covered in snow in a snowstorm.
I assume
lends you to thinking that perhaps that might be the case. But it's no like, ooh, magic sort of to the touch. It's not like touching a magic artifact. Yeah.
Whatever they are, they're definitely not meeting up here anymore.
No.
This is true.
Chairs are all a bit too small to be giant chairs, right?
You've only ever seen a hill giant and a stone giant we established, right?
Mm-hmm.
Actually, no, you've only ever seen a hill giant. The hill giant, there is a chair, the wooden one that Tilly has sat on that looks giantish in the size it would be.
I love how Tilly picked the biggest chair.
Mm-hmm.
No, Tilly picked the second smallest chair.
Oh.
Oh, wait. These are big chairs then?
Yes, these are huge.
Oh, right.
Oh shit,
never mind. Right,
okay. Oh.
There is the dwarven chair is small and the rest are massive. Each one getting bigger than the last one.
Okay.
The final chair is probably about 11 feet to the bit you sit on. I don't know what that bit's called.
Okay, now me as me feels like I've figured something out. Okay. Can I look through the Tinker's notes to see if there's anything mentioning any, along the lines of a meeting place with giant chairs? I mean, I assume it's not his business in general, but like it's the only thing I took with me of information about around here. So,
make an investigation check for me.
Because we know that the gang, original gang at Karas Hokal, was having problems with giants. They were kicking him out to have the Kalaras.
And I'm pretty sure at some point we did hear or find the term the Ordning. Or am I just putting that in my own head?
No, we heard that, surely.
Yeah, that was the Hill Giants.
That was the Hill Giants themselves, right. Yeah.
Okay. You didn't see them fighting, you didn't see them kicking giants out, you saw them kicking orcs out.
Oh, orcs. Right.
Okay, fair enough. So what check was I making again, sorry?
Intelligence check. Investigation, sorry.
Investigation.
With guidance, because of course.
Oh, with guidance. Oh, yeah. Sweet.
Amari spends 6 seconds giving you the heebie-jeebies.
look at that peach. That peach.
Okay, so that's a D4, right?
Yeah.
So a total 20.
20?
Total, yeah.
Let me just check your previous checks for the book. Okay. So, flicking through this book once more. This time, not being in the darkness of the hole, not being sort of as panicked as before, there's a secret page at the back.
Dun, dun, dun.
You'd never noticed it before until now. It's glued in as sort of there's a page, there's a piece of paper has been put over the top and glued over this last page.
Mm-hmm. I would like to look at this particular page, please.
Cut it open?
As delicately as possible, yeah.
Okay. You cut it open and as you fold it over, two things are on the page. The first, the pressed remains of the High Tinker's eyeballs.
Lovely.
And the second is scrawled in blood in horrible letters. Don't let it see the light.
Oh. guys, found a thing.
Found what?
Turn around and show them the extra page.
God damn. That's eyes. Do you see what I see?
I appreciate the attempt. But yeah, guys, this is an omen of ill tidings. I can only assume it means the lantern. And it's outside now.
Cloak straight back on.
unless there's something else in there that we didn't find. But I'm assuming it's the lantern. Or whatever's inside it.
What happens if it sees a light? I mean, would it go free? Would it? Why are there eyes on the page? And
this is why there are eyes on the page. Usually, when you squish them, they go pop.
It's like a pressed flower.
Ram.
So gross.
At least they were no food references this time, so
give it time. Progress.
But they're like facing forward at the eyes.
Well, the wording of the note as well, it said, don't let it see the light.
Mm-hmm.
And there's eyes in the page.
Yes.
So maybe it's more, don't let it see the light. And maybe that's why they've been all afraid of
mad
light sources.
They've gone mad too.
They have.
Obviously, plucked out eyeballs is not a sign of sanity.
I doubt it's a ceremonial thing either, removing your eyes. So, whatever he's done it for a reason.
That one we bumped into in the temple was very much not a fan of light.
Yeah. I mean, I still have a spell left. I could potentially test it with daylight.
It's written in blood.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, I feel like it's a warning to be heeded.
Okay.
I feel like also that guy had just torn his eyes out and, you know, had like blood all over his hands, maybe.
Yeah, I'm wondering if he tore his eyes out before writing it or after, because he needed the blood from somewhere. Maybe he's one out and then right and then.
Well, you don't necessarily need to see it to write.
That's true.
It's kind of helpful though, otherwise you end up like going off the page or just like.
I think we're getting into the semantics of the word creepy note, maybe?
You see now as this wind is blowing, the clouds are beginning to be blown away.
I mean,
okay,
the
clouds.
Yeah, I'm freezing my ass off, like.
I'm gonna give my cloak to Gunn because I might be able to stay warmer a little bit better than she would.
Okay.
There possibly being something bad going on with this lantern and sunlight, I'm gonna like get down off the moss chair and maybe move a little bit away from it.
Okay.
I mean, it is still night though, right?
Yes. Slowly, the clouds are moving away and you're beginning to see the first beams of moonlight touch down all over this platform.
Guys, at this point, just fuck it. We're not gonna get it inside in time.
Yeah, and I mean, what's the other alternative? We just carry it around until what? Who said he didn't write that in there to keep it in there? What if showing it light gives it power enough to escape or something?
That's what I was thinking too.
By this point, the moonlight is completely covering the area. The clouds at this point almost completely gone, revealing a beautiful night sky below. The stars twinkle above.
I'm going to use Armor of Agathis, to be sure.
Okay. Everyone take up positions just in case.
Yeah, I'm right at the back.
I'm carrying over the light we came across.
It's fresh, no, yeah?
Yeah.
I'm just packing it over the top of me.
White deafing it.
Seem
wait,
higher.
Who's got the Thane's diadem? Is it me?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Gotta climb in the snow and get the most severe hypothermia possible.
I think you're currently wearing the diadem?
No, I didn't put it on. Okay. I took it. But I am gonna put it on now.
Okay.
By the way, prestidigitate, just anything. Free charge in the ring.
You turn a little bit of snow to water.
No, I make it glow briefly, just as like a...
Actually, before you do that, I'm going to cast Protection from Good and Evil on you at second level.
Okay.
And then I'm going to back the fuck up.
All right. Your mic's a bit far away, by the way, Angie.
Oh.
Yeah, you're a bit quiet, girl.
Shouldn't be.
All right.
All right. Okay. Dynamon.
Yep.
Cloak off. I'm forcibly ejected from the mountain.
As you pull the cloak off. The moonlight touches the lantern and immediately the purplish light it's been giving out changes, folding over to a brilliant golden glow. Slowly you see cracks begin to form in the lantern. Four bits begin falling out. And then all of a sudden, the lantern detonates, the top of it flying off, landing somewhere and tumbling down the sides of the mountain. You just hear a cling, cling, cling as it goes. And from within the mountain, you see something uncurls out into the night sky, a creature, equine in nature, but with a long tail that trails off its back legs like a comet. Huge stag-like antlers from the top of its head that are bright red in fashion, a mane of burning celestial fire, claws instead of hooves, and instead of fur, you see scales of vibrant, bright, and brilliant gold. And as it ascends into the sky around you, the sheer size of it eclipses all of you as it stares down upon you, coiling around the air atop this mountain, this bright light emanating out everywhere. And as it stares down upon you all, you hear a comforting voice from within your minds that rumbles with a softness. Dark Breakers, I do not know how long it has been since I stood upon this realm, but know that you have given a great gift to me this day. I am Faranif. And for your service, I will grant upon you all the most powerful thing that anything can give. A single question. To know the answer is my duty. The question is yours.
We need a smart talky one because I'm going to ask someone really stupid. I'm not, I don't have a question. That's why, like.
I think I'm probably just a little bit dumbstruck, marveling at this huge, shiny creature.
Mm-hmm.
Probably happy crying.
Mm-hmm.
My face is quite serious. Taking things over.
I'm not giving up my position in the snow.
That would be a tactical misstep.
It would be.
Had to go messy step.
I walk up.
As you step closer up onto the platform once more, this figure surrounding you, curling around.
This question is more of a personal one. What happened to them?
They fulfilled their end of their bargain for their greatest treasure. You and your sister.
Yeah.
Pull that fist. Give me that.
Yeah, Tristan's lost all composure at this point. Would probably, yeah, would have definitely dropped to his knees. And just falls silent.
There is still hope. In time, you will find your answers to your other questions.
Are you sure there's only one you can answer right now?
Technically, that's a second.
My gifts are not so easily given. Dance. To you all, I give you this. You will feel now as the pressure builds in your forehead and temples, and you force to close your eyes for a moment. As you all open them, they blaze golden, a sigil appearing, floating above your forehead for a moment before your eyes fade to their normal colors and the sigil disappears. Call upon the power when you will. As it speaks, you see in the air behind it, a gate begins to form. Great marble pillars erupting from nowhere, and as they reach their apex and join together in an arch, the doors that have momentarily appeared swing open, revealing only bright light. And as the figure twists around it once more, it goes through the door. And as it does, the door shatters, forming points of light, stars in the sky, in the shape of a horse.
I think I walk back up and pat Tristan on the back and say, if it makes you feel any better, bud, I really would have wasted that.
I want to just put my hand on his shoulder too. Get up. You're getting all cold and red.
Yeah. Yeah. I hope there wasn't anything pressing that anyone really needed to ask. But
right, yours was better.
This is worth it.
I mean, it's the question. So I couldn't pass up the chance. I'm sorry. But hey, bright side, didn't kill us. Yet.
No, it didn't.
You know,
yet.
You know, maybe it's playing a game where it makes us think that it's done something really nice, and then all of a sudden we're gonna get swiped off the side of the mountain. So let's
very yeah. Really optimistic.
So pessimistic.
Well, I like stories, so this would have.
Speaking of getting knocked off the side of the mountain, we should probably start doing that the safe way.
Yeah. And hopefully not through a mountain and find a whale again.
Yeah.
That was the best part of that trip, though, I must say.
I remember a lot of parts that were much worse.
Yeah, that's why I said the whale.
You found a whale?
In a mountain.
You see, there is a second path off the top of this mountain. It seems to wind in a different area to the one you came up. It seems to lay it down.
We're going to go down the side of the mountain rather than back through the Calras.
Definitely.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm partial to a sunrise any minute now. So I'd rather be on the outside of it.
All right, let's get moving. I'm freezing my tits off a bit.
I'm gonna pick up the extra cloak and wrap myself with it. That way, it's not left up here.
So he's taking Gunn's cloak.
Well, so I gave Gunn mine, and hers was still wrapped around the thing.
After a couple of steps of tripping off over your larger size cloak, I'd be like, just give me mine back.
Yes, swap.
So as you go to make your way down the mountain. The first peaks of sun begin to make their way across the distant eastern horizon as you take your first steps down the mountainside. The Dwarven Road is in disrepair, but still sturdy. Travel is easy. And the sun is barely at 7 a.m. by the time you catch that first scent of forest air. It's not long before you're down the mountain once more. Green grass below your feet. And no darkness around you at all.
Ow, it's really bright.
Probably stare into the sun much too long just because I can and then look around.
Yeah, I mutter a prayer of thanks.
I can't see. That's nice.
The Mari, you shouldn't do that. You'll go blind and I'm sure they're nice.
Worth it. Worth it.
So how long do you think the guide's going to wait
for? I can't see what you're showing me because everything is bright.
Right, the guide was at the entrance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he said he'd wait a little bit and then he'd leave. So he'll make his way back.
But we also don't know quite how long we were there.
Yeah.
We at one point we were dwarves.
I mean,
and that's not a bad thing. Also, just a very unusual thing.
Mm.
Just, I mean, I was still a dwarf. Nothing changed for me. That was just.
It wasn't too different for me.
I mean, my mustache was spectacular.
You should grow it out like that.
I'm debating it. Just to see the look on Gunn's face.
You'll see my shaving razor come the nighttime too, bud.
Would you do that?
Yes.
I thought dwarves prided facial hair, so would you deprive me?
I think that might be cultural appropriation though.
No, yours would just be an insult to mustaches and beards everywhere. I've seen what you're working with and I'm not that impressed.
Oh, that's harsh.
It's fine, we'll let her speak these lies. It's fine.
Never mind.
In all seriousness, no, I have memorized this path. I'm like, I'm not going to forget this path. I'm not going to forget this place. It is good to be out of there.
Mm-hmm.
Though.
Back
for now.
I'm a city girl, but I'm so close to hugging a tree.
It's the elf in you.
Yeah.
That's...
Does that get stronger after a while? It's worrisome.
Anyway, are we making our way back to town, or are we going to go back to the entrance to get the guy?
I assume we can find our way back to town. He's a guide. He knows where he's going.
Yeah, we'll just say that we ended up coming out of a different exit, which we did.
It's not a lie.
And we didn't see him anywhere.
They said everyone that goes in there doesn't come back out. We've got a lot of bragging to do.
Yeah.
I'm sure we'll find Stead in the same place we found him the first time.
Unless he's, like, very... Maybe he thought we were coming back. Maybe he has a lot of faith in us. And we're just going to wander away.
Did that man look like he had faith in us?
Didn't he say he takes the equipment off the people that die?
He did.
Mm-hmm.
He might still be waiting.
Maybe.
Does that mean he goes inside? Surely not.
I don't think so. And there wasn't really anything dangerous before the inside part.
Well, there was a lot of bone.
There was like ogres.
Good point.
Giants.
Good point.
How far from the entrance do we reckon we are? Like, do we know roughly what side of the mountain we're on?
You're currently on the eastern side of the mountain. And you came in on the southeastern side of the mountain.
Okay. And in terms of going back, would it be too much out of the way to circle back around to the entrance?
You'd go past that way anyway, if you were going back to Silver.
See if he's there.
Yeah. Popper's head's in.
Popper's head's in.
Fancy a copper. Oh, he's not in.
Get a kettle on.
So, who's leading the way?
Nature boy.
Yeah. I was just about to say.
All right. Survival check for me then, buddy.
Yeah, just go a little bit ahead, everybody, and that's a survival 26.
Okay, and a d12, please.
Oh, I have one of those, totally. Oh, I actually do. That's a 1.
Okay.
You've run into a tree.
So you continue to make your way back towards town. You pass by the entrance of the cave and no stead.
Fair enough. That settles that then.
Yeah, can I keep an eye to see if he's left any tracks? Like, I don't know whether he was careful to leave nothing on the way here, or... that's a 19 again, so that's another 26.
There are some tracks. It does not look like Stead was being particularly subtle.
Okay, sorry, I was just questioning my own basic arithmetic there.
19 plus 7 is indeed
yes.
26.
Thank you. So if I can see that he's begun to make his way back anyway,
mm-hmm.
I'll just keep leading us towards the town.
Okay.
Just a good 20, 30 feet ahead, everybody.
Yeah. And eventually the foothills and forests begin to clear until you find yourself back on the road, the end, the Glintmarch roadway. Not far beyond lie the gates of Silgar.
Well then.
I feel like we haven't eaten in ages. Should we just go back to the place where we met him?
Yeah.
Food, maybe he's there.
Yeah, I mean, this vial with the snow in is enchanted in some way, so that's, I assume, is going to be fine for a while. Unless, Tilly, you want to run along and
the longer
meet
the time
that guy again.
The longer the time before we have to see him again, the better.
I felt like that was going to be the answer.
Don't we also have to pay him, considering we've survived?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't think we can afford it.
I mean, we have some coin. How much coin do we have?
We have less than we ever tell anybody about.
It's good business sense.
I just like go. Do you know what this means?
What?
This means that I am the self-declared thane of Kalraz Hawkel, and you have my gold. So all this wee business is mine. Now it's a good job that I'm a very, very benevolent thane, and I am willing to share it with you all.
How many of you speak Dwarven?
Me.
Does she say that?
Rose of the Youth speak Dwarven. Roll the history check.
While she's talking, can I mage hand the try and mage hand diadem off her head? Just have it above.
14.
Floating above
her. History, did you say?
Yes.
16.
10.
Well, only you're like, oh, right, oh, okay. Tristan and Ronan, you're like, wait, that's not how that works.
I studied the language, not the culture.
I'll look to Tristan, and I'll say in Elvish, a benevolent leader indeed.
Back in Elvish. Oh, yeah, that's definitely not how that works. And I have the money, so... with a smile on the face the entire time. That, like, they're definitely talking about us, but don't know what they're saying.
Namari knows.
Mm-hmm. You look up and the diadem is floating, like, a good half foot above your head, and this little hand holding on to it.
You're all a bunch of bastards. Buy me a pint.
I mean, at the rates we are getting, I think we have to buy you more than one.
Technically, yeah. It would be you buying pain.
Oh, yeah, gun. Like... The hat comes off, the cape gets swooshed, and it's the most ostentatious bow you've ever seen.
I curtsy. And let the diadem drop back on her head.
Laugh it up, you dickheads. We'll see what happens next time you're in a fight. Laugh it up.
As long as it's not a giant, I walk off on towards the bar.
You're walking towards the gates.
Yep.
When you get to the gates, the two guards are like, look to each other. Look back to you. Look to each other. What are you doing here?
Waiting for you to open the gates.
We've bought rooms for the night. We already have lodgings within the city. That is.
You left to Krypton.
Now we're back.
Now we're back. Put two and two together, love.
Denevant, am I drunk? I think I might be drunk. I smell toast.
Are these the same idiots that we ran into before?
Yep.
Beautiful.
The other one goes, well, I'm not in any mood to refute your claim, and, well, whatever. Go in. Pushes the gate open.
Wow. Is it that easy to get past Kerry? Yeah.
Only when we're in the presence of royalty.
This is true.
So you make
it right. I had rose petals. I'm sprinkling them on the ground before you get there.
I avert my gaze. Keep nodding.
Is it like the King and I? No one can be higher than...
Walk around like that. Oh, no.
Et cetera, et cetera.
Everyone else is just doing the deepest squat ever and just trying to walk.
You'll thank me when we have the best asses of any adventuring party in the world, because of Dem Squash.
Just about to say that.
I'll have you know, I do, which is why I wear a long coat, so that people don't get too distracted.
Not because it's like flat.
It's not.
That's so selfless of you.
I know. Before.
Let's just go to the pub. Fucking hell, before this gets worse.
We need food and drink, Jesus Christ.
Did you make your way across town? You open the door of the establishment you'd previously been in. The, what was it called?
The Thingy Majiggy.
It's a good name.
We're not the dive bar at the docks, right?
No, you're not the dive bar at the docks.
No.
Let me check. One sec. You're at the, Jesus. Been in there a while. I don't actually think that I
could just make
fancy tankard or something.
That sounds right.
The fancy tankard, 8 beers, 1 silver today only.
Yes!
The fancy tankard. There you go. So, you make your way inside, and as you open the door, you step inside, and the crowd quiets, and you hear a couple of tankards. Ting, ting, ting.
Have that effect.
And you hear a grinding of chairs. Stead gets up and goes, oh.
My cape is billowing. It's like...
Axe over the shoulder, acting all nonchalant, but flexing like fuck.
And Stead passes out.
Have to pay him?
Well, I suppose we have to get used to that.
That's pretty cool.
You see Betsy is on, stood on top of the bar as she usually is. She's like, what are you doing here?
We're a bit thirsty.
So. Not the first person to ask us that.
We've had an interesting day.
Thank you, Shola. You're the first person to come back from that place.
And without a scratch, scratches all over.
I think this deserves a round for you all.
To start, yeah, let's go.
Right.
Well, not one to turn down good hospitality.
Finest dwarven wine it is, then. She opens up a bottle. Thump. Starts pouring glasses out. Looks up at you all. Pours another bit in each glass. Yeah. And slides them along the bar towards you.
Only the finest for Her Majesty.
Curtsy.
Now, and then with the wine in hand, I sort of turn from the bar to everyone else. It's like,
Well, I'm assuming you're all waiting to hear the tale. You're going to have to wait a little bit longer. And then I go back to everyone else. Showbiz, it's an art. Keep them wanting more.
I raise a small toast to the innocent people of Calraz Harkle. Drinking their memories.
So you all toast to Calraz Harkle. The bar begins to liven up a bit more once again. You find yourselves now back on the slightly uncomfortable stools of this tavern, sat together once more, alive and safe.
Hopefully we'll stay that way.
And breathe.
So,
did we still have rooms here? Is that something that we
had? Fuck, how long were we gone? Yeah.
That's maybe a good week. It's been less than a week.
Does that sound reasonable as to how long we've, like, in our memory being gone? Obviously without the whole, like, turning into dwarves.
In your memory, you've been gone for 4 days.
So there's been a few days added on.
Our memory, can I ask Betsy, how long were we away?
About 3 days.
Hey.
Give or take a bit. You know, you got to understand.
Sounds about right. Is Stet here anywhere?
You want to share passed out back there.
Oh, was that him? Oh, sorry. Yeah. Is he back unconscious?
No, he's still passed out. Everyone's just leaving him.
I'll put down a tankard next to him for when he wakes up and step over him and back to the bar and back to the... just tap him on the cheek.
For some reason, when Stu reached, then I thought he was going to roll to see if he could smell it while he was passed out. Wakes up.
Do we want to give the snow over now and then leave first thing in the morning, or do whatever the next thing tomorrow? We can get fresh start.
We could get it over with.
Yeah. Plus, I'm interested to see what he's going to do with it.
Yeah, it's just snow.
What does he want you to do? Control the weather?
I don't know. He's a madman, clearly.
That's true. Oh, and we haven't had enough of them, have we?
This whiskey was pretty good.
What are you saying?
Words.
That's usually your biggest problem.
Yeah. And my greatest asset.
Yeah, and it's so hard to tell the difference sometimes.
I know, right? That's great. Anyway, shall we?
Let's go see the terrible wizard.
Yeah. Okay. So who's going to see Razzmatazz the Magnificent?
I'm going to stay and get wankered.
I want to see Razzmatazz.
Me too.
I feel like he's expecting me to be there, so...
I'm going to give you the vial.
Ronan, Willona?
I think I'm going to hang out with Gunn.
Yeah, as soon as everyone else goes to see the wizard, I'm just going to turn to the two in Elvish and say, mighty thing, and then I'm going to go back up to my rooms just and crash out.
Okay.
Do they say that often? The whole, like, sad conversations? That's the gun.
Yeah.
It must get frustrating as fuck.
Yeah, they're usually talking shit about me in Elvish. They think I don't know, but I do know. They think they're very clever.
You know. Very clever.
No. Let's take a swig.
So, the three of you make your way towards Razzmatazz's tower. As you get close, the door busts open. Razzmatazz goes, my new security system! It works! Oh, it's you.
Okay, what else were you expecting? Here's your stupid snow. And hand over the vial. Is it snowy enough for you?
I had to go through many, many hardships to find it for you.
This will do nicely. Yeah. For my new mojito business. Good day. Slams the door shut.
Well, that was the best way that could have gone.
It really was.
I mean, I applaud his ingenuity.
Yeah.
Maybe from somewhere far away, because maybe his ingenuity is explosive.
Yeah, but the funniest thing to me is this place does not seem like a mojito kind of place.
I mean, you saw his last drink. I'm sure he can change that.
Mm. True, true.
As you're speaking, you hear a from up in the top of the tower.
Told you. I called it. I fucking called it. Should have taken bets.
Should have. Should have, would have, could have.
I guess we go back to the tavern then.
Yep.
Is he dead? I'm gonna listen at the door there.
You hear dunk, 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 dunk. Upstairs.
He's fine. He's fine.
Movement.
I'm it's fine.
Might have just been falling down and breaking things, but.
Yeah. So, meanwhile, back in the tavern.
So, Wallona, what's the plan then?
Well, I'm not sure that I could handle chasing after other things, because I know that Tristan had a chat with the blacksmith woman, Redalia. I think there was that, that you were there, right, the whole thing with the, yes. I don't think I'm good for giants and mountains, and I think I'm going to maybe pursue something else, maybe here in town. Like the grin. Because that seems like something that could be addressed.
Yeah.
And I feel like this town could use a little more hope, so maybe I can stick around and instill them with it a bit.
No, it sounds good. Sounds more focused and a bit less aimless than what we've got going on.
Yeah, you folks tend to wander to interesting places.
You know, variety is the spice of getting nearly disemboweled.
Yeah, I hope that Tristan doesn't get infected.
I'll be fine. It's his leg I'm worried about.
His leg?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that thing has taken a beating. Same leg, too. It's incredible. It's just... Dude has no luck. No luck.
Is it bad luck or good luck? Because it could be both legs.
Oh, it's bad luck. It's just the one. Just the one leg. But it's just over and over and over and over, and it's almost impressive.
Yeah, no, I think this may be where we part ways, though.
Yeah. Well, it's been an honor to fight by your side.
Yes, it was. I will remember this journey for years to come.
And this isn't going to be the last time I see you.
Like, I certainly hope not. You folks are absolutely grand.
Well, I want to come back and properly clear that place out sometime. So if you're still in the area, come chill at the new Calras. I'll get it all done up. Hopefully.
I'll keep an ear out and make sure that nobody, you know, decides to go squatting in your...
Yeah, if you can just, like, I don't know, keep an eye out, maybe dissuade some young idiots from trying to go and clear it or whatever. You know, people like us.
Yeah, no. Prevent people from repeating things. No, I think I can manage that.
But go careful with the,
Yeah.
The
grin. I'm still concerned about that kit they took. Even though Namari said I shouldn't be, but it's just,
Yeah, it's always a bit, I don't know, disconcerting when an organization just kind of spirits someone away.
Yeah.
A little weird. Yeah.
A little bit. Is it still nighttime, daytime?
It's daytime.
Okay.
But as the conversation draws to a close, that's where we're going to end tonight's session. Thank you very much for joining us, everyone. Thank you very much to our guest, Angie. She's been fantastic. Loved having her here. And perhaps we'll see her again someday if she survives the grin.
Oh, she comes back.
As he says it with a grin.
So, I hope you all enjoyed that. I hope my players enjoyed it. I hope everyone watching enjoyed it. If you did enjoy it, you can catch up with anything else. If this is your first time here, if you want to see how we got to this point, you can catch up on YouTube. If you go to the link that's being posted in chat right now, you can go see anything there, as well as the other shows that are on this channel, including Bike Club, which should return this Wednesday. Alongside that, Susie streams every weekday night, apart from Thursdays. Catch here for games and art and more role plays. Alongside that, we have our good Christian boy here, Stevie, who streams every evening. You started back up on your big schedule last night, and you'll be streaming from 11 to 1 to 2-ish.
I'll be streaming Warcraft, so it's more likely to be like 11 to about 7 a.m.
That is true. The Warcraft stuff does go on for quite a while. But if you enjoy that, catch him there. He also does a bunch of PUBG as well. It's a great chat. There's quite a lot of funny things happen there. Stevie is renowned for being amazing at driving cars, regardless of the game. And if you like that, go there. Is there anything, anybody else got anything to plug apart from our true streamers?
You can grab the game I make on Steam. There's a Hat in Time. I don't know if we have any news as of late. We added a German translation recently. That's about it.
The Hat in Time.
I knew that was coming when I saw him.
Different watch this time, but it's a Hat in Time. It's actually the pocket watch from Fullmetal Alchemist. So.
The game is way better than that analogy.
Yeah, go please don't let that silly.
I feel like this one works better than the last one.
Sales dropping and dropping and dropping and dropping.
Oh, you just lost all those sales.
Yeah. I can't believe I've been fired.
If anyone else has anything to plug, now is the time.
I'm going to be opening up commissions this upcoming week, so keep an eye out for that if you're interested.
Yes.
And my usual thing, April 13th, D&D in Haunted Vaults in Edinburgh. Should come live soon to reserve seats. I'll post a link on my Twitter when it does.
Fantastic. And I do believe that you will be running a one shot on this channel.
I will. When is that again?
That will be prepared. At the beginning of April. Of April, there'll be two one shots on the channel instead of Curry On for 2 weeks. So look forward to that. Susie is running one, and so is Lydia. If you want to see anything more of us in any of our endeavors, please do follow us on Twitter. We appreciate it a lot. Let us know how we got on. Scream at us when I down Tristan again, or whatever it may be.
And Mari.
And whatever.
Yeah.
So,
doesn't Mari go down more than me?
No.
Mari went down the last time, too.
Yeah.
We'll have to have a half elf.
Half elf.
Oh, Jesus, half elf telly.
It's half.
How many halves are we at this point?
So, thank you very, very much for joining us. We will leave you to the rest of your evenings now. Do head on over to twitch.tv/youngjinxy for some Warcraft action. But for now, thanks very much for watching, and thank you for joining our adventurous tale.